Hello, my name is Fabio Mancini and I am a principal geophysicist at Woodside Energy down in Perth. The title of my lecture is Maximising the Benefits of Full Waveform Inversion. During this presentation, I would like to share some practical examples on how we see FWI to have a great impact in the exploration and development cycle. The lecture outline is very simple. I'll just give a brief introduction of what FWI is and how it works, and then I will explain how we see FWI as a game changer. In particular, I want to focus on how we think we can reduce the seismic processing turnaround time by about 50%. And then I would like to show you how the high resolution velocity can actually use as a direct tool for interpretation. FWI is a data-driven technique that allows you to recover high resolution velocity model with a resolution that is well above what we can do at the moment with travel time tomography. You compare by wiggle data that are acquired in the field with data that we simulate on a computer. Our input is basically a shot gather, an initial velocity field, a wavelet, and the acquisition geometry. With that, we can simulate a shot on a computer, and at the shot at the moment is very simple because we start with a model that is extremely smooth, so we'll have only the direct arrival, the diving waves, and the water bottom multiple. We then compare this shot with our real shot, and we derive something that we call the residuals. And these residuals are what actually drive FWI. We want to minimize these residuals so that the shot computed on the computer will look more or less like the shot that we acquire on the field. We do that in an iterative manner, starting at a low frequency, and then we iterate and we increase the frequency after a few iterations. As you can see, what we're trying to do is to recover a velocity that is a much higher frequency, and possibly the shot now will resemble much more the shot that is acquired on the field. The common use today of FWI is mostly for imaging purposes and is applied after several iterations of travel time tomography. The reason for that is because we want to start from the most accurate possible velocity model to avoid to be stuck in a local minima and what we call cycle skipping. The maximum frequency is never above 10 Hz. That is because for imaging, that's plenty. In our opinion, often it has only a limited impact on the image because travel time tomography usually does an excellent job at recovering the long wavelength of the velocity. This is an exception when the signal-to-noise ratio of the data is poor and tomography struggles, in particular when, for example, in gas cloud, we have very little to peak in the common image gather. Another issue that we see is that it extends the project turnaround time and that makes it a more hard sell with our asset teams. So when do we think FWI can really be a game changer? First, if we could run FWI for imaging but without the need of travel time tomography. In this way, we could exploit the fact that the input of FWI needs very little preprocessing, and we could start the velocity model building phase in parallel with the preprocessing phase. The second point, if we start exploiting the high resolution aspect of the FWI velocity for direct interpretation. At Woodside, we have been using FWI velocity for shallow hazard pore pressure prediction. But one day the real goal is to use this product as a tool for reservoir characterization. The data example that I'm going to show you today are coming from 2D lines that are acquired over the Exmouth sub-basin in Western Australia. The acquisition aimed at testing the benefits of long offset at deep toe. The long offset is essential in FWI in this current implementation because we try to invert mostly diving waves. The diving waves depth of investigation is strictly related to the length of the offset. So the longer the offset, the deeper our investigation with FWI can go. The deep toe is also important because it allows us to acquire data that are away from the swell zone in the ocean and allows to acquire data that are richer in low frequency and they're cleaner. In our 2D lines, the parameter, you can see them there, the streamer length was about 10 kilometers and the receiver depth was 25 meters. So let's start with the first part, the FWI in the low frequency range for imaging but without travel time tomography. Here we derive the starting velocity just by a coarse manual peaking of stacking velocity at 2 km interval. We then inserted an accurate water column to start the FWI. When we migrate the data with this velocity, you can see that the gather is far from being flat. So this model is not really accurate for imaging. And often that turns people off by the idea of using this kind of model for FWI. But this is where the low frequency, a good low frequency, come to our help. In fact, this concept of starting velocity model accuracy in FWI can be considered frequency dependent, i.e. something that is not accurate at 5 Hz can be accurate when we start at 3 Hz. Here in this diagram, I show from left to right, a shot gathering the full bandwidth, and then band limited at 2 or 4 hertz, and then the signal to noise ratio for this band limited gather. The red curve is the signal and the blue curve is the noise. But you can see here we have plenty of good data at about 2 or 3 hertz. So we can actually use this data to start FWI at these kind of frequencies, and we can relax a bit the constraint on the starting velocity model. Before I show you the result of the FWI, I'll give you a chance to familiarize with the kind of geology that we are trying to invert in this line. This is called line 6 from the 2D line set. And you can see we have several geological features that are really interesting. In particular, with the yellow arrows, I highlight several volcanic intrusions that are widespread in this area. Then with the blue arrow, you can see the Cretaceous unconformity that divide two geological subdomains, the shallow part that is characterized by canyon and channels, and the deeper part that is characterized by large tilted fault blocks. The FWI result at 10 hertz. At the top, you can see the starting velocity model. I kept the arrows where our geological features are and where we would like to recover. And at the bottom, you can see the result of the FWI at 10 hertz. And even at 10 hertz, you can start having hints of this geological feature coming through. In particular, you can see some of the volcanic intrusions. Also, the Cretaceous unconformity is taking shape. You can actually see hints as well of the sand bodies in the channels. When we migrate with this velocity, you can see the improvement. On the left here, we have the PSDM with the initial velocity model. On the right, the result with the new velocity model. With the orange arrows, I try to point to some of the major improvement. And when you look at the gather extracted from the blue-green ellipse, you can see how the flatness has dramatically improved. And that is a testimony that the FWI is doing what it's supposed to be doing and is accurately recovering the velocity. Why this is very important for us? Here I show an hypothetical plan for an exploration development project from the beginning, from the acquisition planning toward the end, the drilling. What I want to highlight is that a very large chunk of time is taken by the data processing part. And what happens often is we squeeze the interpretation part where actually our interpreter to work their lead and prospect very hard. If we zoom into the data processing part, we see that the problem is that we work very sequential. We start with the pre-processing, we need to clean up the data before we can move to the velocity model building, because tomography needs clean data. And then we do our imaging part. The idea then here is to get away from this sequential part and parallelize the velocity model building with the pre-processing. And again, the point here is that FWI does not need very heavy pre-processing. In fact, we can almost start from raw data. So our opinion is that we could shorten the whole processing part by about 50%. In fact, if we believe that we can have an FWI product even before the pre-processing part is concluded, we can introduce a different concept, a new concept we call the true fast-track PSDM. In this case, the idea is to start migrating the raw shots with an accurate velocity model, so we compromise on the data, we do not compromise on the velocity. And then we do some post-processing just after migration. Obviously, it's mostly effective in deep water areas where multiple and linear noise have limited impact. But we found it that could be very valuable when the timeline between award of the block and the drill or drop decision is very tight. You can see on the image on the right, our gather has got the primary event are nice and flat, but you can see there are plenty of multiple and linear noise. But this is things that we can easily take care of in the post-imaging processing. So how does it look like on the image? On the top is our fast-track PSDM. We think that in an average size survey, we can produce this image in about 3 months after end of acquisition. And at the bottom is the image at full processing. Obviously, the image at the bottom looks much sharper. In particular, in this case, it's the deghosting that makes a great difference, as highlighted on the orange arrow. But structurally, those two images should look very similar. And the idea is to give this image in about 3 months to our interpreter to give them a very clear head start before actually getting the final image 12 months later. Now, let's have a look at what happens when we push the high frequencies into the velocity model and why we believe this one is a great tool for direct interpretation. Here on the right, you can see just a reminder of the input velocity model, very smooth. And on the left, you see the result of the FWI when we push it to 30 hertz. And now I think is where really FWI can shine. You can see a lot of details coming through. I left the same arrows as I indicated before, and now you can really see above all on the volcanics the fantastic definition that FWI has given. When we overlaid this image onto the PSDM stack, you can see that they match very closely. And this is, for us, is one of the best QC that we can do to be sure that the FWI has converged into a correct solution. So how can we use these kind of velocities? In this area, we had another line that was overlaying a well that we drilled a couple of years before. So our pore pressure prediction group asked us to produce an FWI result on this line to compare with the pore pressure prediction that was calculated at the well. So we did that, and on here I'll show you the result. On the top, we have our very smooth input velocity model derived by manual velocity peaking. At the bottom, you can see the FWI velocity at 30 Hz. In this case, we didn't have volcanic intrusion, but what I think is fantastic to look is the definition of the fault blocks under the Cretaceous unconformity. They come out really clean and clear to see. We gave the result to our pore pressure prediction team, and they came back with this image. On the top, you see the velocity, and on the bottom is the pore pressure prediction that has been derived by this FWI velocity. What is remarkable is to see the clear definition of the compartment of pressure. And this is a kind of result that you will never be able to see from a travel time tomography. The well line is shown in the middle, called well A, and we extract the pressure prediction at the well and the pressure prediction from FWI. You can see that they match very closely, and that shows on the right, where the red is the FWI velocity, and in the black is the well velocity. This is a great potential. In particular, we can really start to control the well design, and we can actually reduce some rig time, and also reduce the number of spare parts that we have to take with us during drilling. So, not everything is perfect. We know that we still have issues and limitations. I try to divide them in three parts, one mostly to do with geophysical issues, then data-related and hardware-related. From a geophysical point of view, we still struggle with multi-parameter inversion, in particular with anisotropy. There is a large trade-off between anisotropic parameter and velocities. And that's not just a problem with FWI, it's a problem often for travel time tomography as well. So can we invert reliably for it? If we can't, can we use the parameter derived from tomography to help us in FWI? On the data side, as mentioned before, the long offset is a must. Because we are limited on inverting diving waves at this point in time, our depth on investigation is about one third of the cable length. So 95% of our data is a narrow azimuth streamer, where a streamer length is about 6 to 8 kilometers. You realize that we cannot go down to our target depth. The low frequency content is essential to assure convergence, as I showed before. From a computational point of view, we know that FWI is expensive, and more so when we go to higher frequency. In fact, the cost of computation goes on the fourth power of the frequency. If we color-coded this issue with a traffic light system, we see that, in our opinion, some of these issues are easy to solve. In particular, the low frequency nowadays, with the modern acquisition and deep toes, are an issue that is already been solved. From a hardware side, there is nothing that impedes us to buy a large computer. There is also a possibility to start using cloud computing, where we can borrow a large amount of nodes for a limited amount of time and release them when the project is complete. From a geophysical point of view, we know that we haven't solved the multi-parameter inversion, but sometimes average value anisotropy allows the FWI solution to produce a result that is acceptable for our needs. The real showstopper at the moment is the maximum depth of investigation of the FWI limited to the cable depth. So there are two solutions to that. The first one, we acquire longer offset, but this one has a cost implication. And the second, we start thinking about using FWI with the reflection data, but where the reflection data not only update the short wavelength or the velocity field, but also the long wavelength. So this leads us to the conclusion. I hope that I show you that even in the current implementation, FWI can have a large impact in the exploration and production cycle. In particular, I show that if we use FWI without tomography, we are confident that we can shorten the turnaround time of our seismic project by about 50%. To do that, we need low frequency and long offset in the data. The second point is that FWI at high frequency can really be used for direct interpretation. In particular, at the moment, we are using it for pore pressure prediction and shallow hazard, but the ultimate goal is to use this kind of product for reservoir characterization. As I showed, the main limitation of the current version of FWI is the data. Our conventional narrow azimuth streamer just lacks the kind of offset that we need to produce a successful FWI target depth. And finally, I would like to acknowledge Woodside and Mitsui E&P Australia for allowing me to show this lecture. I also would like to thank Mike Warner, Adrian Ampleby, and Tenis Nangua, the Fullway Consortium of the Imperial College, for their continuous help in FWI. And thank you all for your attention. Thank you.